Wow, wasn't that a bumper? Okay. Well, everybody, welcome here. So good to be with you all again. Thank you so much for being here this morning. If you haven't met me yet, my name's Cory. I am the campus pastor here. I get the privilege of opening up God's Word most Sundays here at our North Shore campus. This morning, we're starting this brand new series, as you saw on the screen, called Strangers in a Strange Land, and it's based out of the New Testament book of 1 Peter. And so if you don't have a Bible, you can find one likely underneath one of the seats in front of you. So if you kind of look down, there's a little shelf there. You can kind of grab a Bible from there. And we're going to be on page 1014 on that Bible, okay? So if you have a Bible that's not under there and you turn to 1014, you might not get to the right location. So just so you know. Now, if you also need a Bible, let me just tell you that we'd love to give you a complimentary free Bible at the back. Just head on out after the service to our guest information counter and see the team that's out there. They'd love to be able to give you a free Bible as well as a little gift bag just to say thanks for being here this morning. Now, this book, 1 Peter, is it's written by, guess who? By Peter. And it's actually written really just shortly before Peter's own death, his own martyrdom, actually. Peter died in 64 AD, approximately, and he writes this little book, this five-chapter book, shortly before the Emperor Nero. Emperor Nero in Rome unleashes his horrific persecution of Christians, also in 64 AD. Peter, as you may know, in terms of church history, we're told that Peter died by crucifixion at Nero's order. And Peter requested that in his death, he would, if he's going to be crucified upside down on a cross, because he did not want to be crucified the same way as the Lord, because he thought that that was far too glorious a thing, basically, for him to be crucified the same way as his Lord. So here we are, Peter writing this just before the Neronic persecution unfolds. And if you know anything about Nero, you know that he's a horrible, cruel Roman emperor. He took Christians back in that day, and because the city of Rome went on in flames, he blamed the Christians for that. He arrested Christians. He crucified the Christians. He used their bodies to line the street, and then he lit them on fire as torches to line the street, took their bodies down, and then threw them to dogs. Now, Peter wrote before all of that unfolded in Rome. And we know that Peter wrote this before that because in chapter 2, he tells us about honoring the emperor, basically, honoring the king, showing respect to him. There's no indication in the book that sort of the persecution of Nero has hit Rome or the Roman provinces even, but here Peter writes this book. Now, Peter's recipients, those who are receiving this book, they're not located in Rome. Our text for this morning tells us that. But they are living in an environment that's still Roman. They are a group of Christians that are scattered throughout five different Roman provinces, as we'll see in the first verse, provinces such as Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. This is where they're scattered. And we know that they are dealing with the early onset, if you could call it that, the beginning stages of greater persecution and suffering that's going to come through the hands of the Roman Emperor Nero. A couple of places in the book of 1 Peter, we read how the church at that time, the believers, are suffering. Peter says, don't be surprised at the fiery ordeal that's coming upon you, as though this is something that you shouldn't be expecting. He talks in there about the trials and the testing that they're going through. He talks about how they're being maligned, how they're being falsely, wrongly accused. But if you think about persecution, persecution is really on a continuum. It's not just simply sort of a physical manifestation where there's martyrs on the other end of that. That's certainly persecution. But there's more of a continuum to it. It's basically like a movement from insult that eventually can move into injury, right? It starts with the insults and can culminate in death. Well, this group of churches that Peter writes to, these followers of Jesus, were at that earlier stage, difficult stage. They were dealing with those insults, but they were certainly on their way, as many of the other Roman churches were, to injury. And Peter writes this letter in the midst of their sort of early struggles and battles with this to encourage them to keep on keeping on despite the difficulties that were surrounding them. Here's how the letter opens up. Here's his first initial comments. And we're going to look this morning just at two verses. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. Peter's opening comments here are intended to be an actual encouragement in the midst of the garbage that they were facing and the culture in which they were living. In this opening section, these first two verses, Peter gives them two words that we're going to zone in on this morning. The words elect and the words exiles. Elect exiles. He wants these believers to hang on to these two words, to hang on to these truths in the midst of the sufferings that they're going through. So this morning, let's look at our text, and we're going to look at each of these words one by one. First of all, I want you to note in verses 1 and 2 that Peter tells us that we are elect of God. We are elect. Again, he says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect. To those who are elect. And he tells us specific things about the elect. He gives us actually three statements about the elect of God that are here. He certainly calls us elect exiles, and we're going to look at that later, but I want us to zone in on what he means by elect. He says, to those who are elect, he tells them three things. In verse 2, he refers to how they were elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in the sanctification of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. Peter reminds those early Christians that they have, number one, been selected according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. If you think about election, that's what election is. It's God's choice or God's selection of you as an individual. He's selected these believers, and he did so according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Notice as I put the text together in chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, Peter says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. As you initially read this text in verse 1 and 2, you kind of have to put this together, that he sort of has this piece in between where he talks about being exiles of the dispersion. But his point is to say, we are elect, and here's how we are elect, according to the foreknowledge of the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, and for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. The Word of God repeatedly affirms, by way of encouragement actually for you and for me, that we've been chosen by God, that we are his elect people. Even as we turn the page from chapter 1 in 1 Peter to chapter 2, you get into verse 9, and what do we read in that passage? That you, he says to the church there, you are a chosen race. When he says race, we have to remember that in the kingdom of God, there's people of all ethnicities that are gathered in the kingdom. He's talking about being a chosen people. Whether you're barbarian or Scythian or slave or free, or whether you're male or female, whether you're black or white or Asian, whatever you are part of this. If you know Jesus, you're a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, he says, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And notice this, verse 10, once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The moment you are chosen by God, you are brought into his family, you belong to him. You belong to him. But notice what he says, though. Not only that you're elect, he says you're elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. What does that mean, to be elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father? Well, there are two basic views that I want to kind of just quickly give you this morning in terms of understanding that language of being elect or chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. One view looks at it this way. They say, well, God is all-knowing, and that is correct. In fact, both views hold to this view, that God is all-knowing. He, of course, knows absolutely everything. But this view in particular says that what God does is, long before any of us ever existed, he looks into the future. If you can kind of imagine God doing, he's looking into the future long before you and I ever exist, and he knows at a certain point in time, when you hear the message of the good news about Jesus, you will respond favorably to that message. You will hear the good news of the gospel preached, and you will say, yes, I want to follow Jesus. Because of what he sees in the future, the decision that you make, he then, all the way before that ever happens, he chooses you, but he chooses you or elects you based upon your decision that he sees. Okay? That's view number one. That is actually probably, well, in many respects, probably the most popular, dominant view that probably exists and has existed for a long time. But it's certainly not the only one that has also been very popular throughout the history of our faith. There's also another view that says that this isn't just about God's foreseen faith, that he can look into the future and see that you will have faith, but it's actually a word for known or foreknowledge that carries with it the idea of God's intimate knowledge of you, but beyond that, his love and his affection for you. It's like in the Old Testament, when you'd read throughout the Old Testament, where it says, for example, that Adam knew his wife Eve. It's not just saying in that text that he knows that she's there, but there's rather some sort of like an intimate connection that exists between Adam and Eve. In that context, it's even beyond that, isn't it? It's marital intimacy that he's talking about. It's the same kind of language that God uses for knowledge of his own people as well. It's not that he just knows you, but he's actually set his love and affection upon you from eternity past. So God chooses you or elects you according to his foreknowledge, means the idea that long beforehand, long before you and I ever existed, he selected you. There was nothing specifically about you that made you or me worthy of that. He just, out of his great love for you, chose you. For, meaning before, and knew or knowledge, is the idea of intimate love that God has for you. Long before you ever existed, God the Father set his love and affection upon you, and he brought you so that he would bring you to himself. Those are the two views. In Ephesians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul put it this way. He said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. So we know that this choice that the Father made for us existed long before the world's foundation was ever laid. And he said he chose us that we should be blameless or holy and blameless. And notice, in love, he predestined us. In other words, he set his love, has set his affection upon us. Or maybe one other verse to consider in light of what Peter has to say is Romans chapter 8, verse 29, where the Apostle Paul says, for those whom he foreknew, there's that word again, those whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he called. And those whom he called, he justified. And those he justified, he glorified. Notice in this passage, it starts with foreknowledge. It goes to predestination. That is God choosing beforehand what your destiny will be. And then he calls you, and then he justifies you. And ultimately, he glorifies you. That is, you get to be with him in glory. The important question to ask about this text and the one in here in 1 Peter is this: what did he foreknow? Or maybe, who did he foreknow? So does God foreknow a person's faith, or does he foreknow the person? You see, if he's foreknowing simply, foreknowledge of the person's faith, one would want to ask, where in the text does it actually say that God foresees their faith? It doesn't say anything about a foreseen faith. What it does tell us is this in Romans 8:9, those whom he foreknew. It's referring to his knowledge of people, not of their faith. Okay? It's a little bit challenging sometimes to track with this if this is new territory for you, but it's his knowledge of people, not of their decisions. Notice that. Those he foreknew, he predestined. Right? We were chosen or elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, Peter tells us. If you think about this, if we just take Romans 8:29, when it says those whom he foreknew, he predestined, and we said foreknow here means that God knows everything and he knows everything in advance, and we would say, yes, he does, absolutely. But if we want to say this passage is telling us that God foreknew that you would believe in the future, and because of that he predestined you, and because of that he called you, and because of that he justified you, and because of that you're going to be glorified, we bump into another problem, and that is this: God knows everyone, right? I mean, there's not a single human being that ever existed or ever will exist that God doesn't already know in his omniscience in advance. This text would be saying too much. For those whom he foreknew, he predestined. Well, he foreknows absolutely everyone. So what people have to do who want to sort of suggest that God is foreseeing faith in that person is they have to insert that idea into this text. It's not coming from the text, right? Because it doesn't say in the text, those whom God foresaw faith in, right? He says, it's a foreknowledge of people. And again, this idea of foreknow is that it beforehand, the word know is the same kind of language in Old Testament that Abraham knew his wife, that Adam knew Eve. It has this idea of loving, intimate care and concern from the Father. What Peter is telling this church from the very beginning, right out of the gates, is that in the midst of all of the calamitous things that you are encountering, you need to know that you are elect of God. That the Father who loves you from eternity has set that love and affection upon you. Though the world falls apart all around you, he is the one who has chosen you. You are a royal priesthood, a people belonging to God. Once you were not, and you don't fit into this world anymore, but you do fit with him. One of the concerns that I've had over the years about this issue, which I've studied enormously over the years, is just the issue of what we do with the text. You see, I don't think Peter intended for me to have all of those comments in this sermon, to be honest with you. I have to make those comments because they're there and we want to know, how did that work? How does that happen? But you see, it actually misses the point in a sense. Why did Peter write what he wrote there? Why did Peter say to the church that you are the elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father? Why did he say that? He wasn't saying that so that you and I could sit down and do theology together, have a debate and a discussion, right, about whether it's foreknowledge in the sense of foreseen faith or whether it's the idea of God foreloving us. Those are important things. We have to pull those out. But again, the purpose for which he wrote that wasn't so that we would have a theological discussion about it. The purpose was so that the church would have been encouraged. So for example, when I come to often Ephesians chapter 1, and Paul has this long run-on sentence in Ephesians 1 where he says, Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his glorious riches, he's chosen us, he's predestined us, and he goes on, and it's massive, one long run-on sentence in Greek, and it's filled with praise. The point of all of that is the readers of that letter are supposed to go, God, thank you. Like, thank you that you chose me. I didn't deserve the choice, but thank you. Thank you that you lavished this out of me. You poured out your love for me that you've given me. But what we make about it is like, well, I don't know. Did he choose us this way or that way? And we miss the point. Now, I'm not suggesting that both aren't important. They are. We want to understand. We want to understand. But we can also miss the purpose for which it was written. Paul didn't write Ephesians 1 so that you and I would have long debates in history of the faith over election and predestination, which has happened. He wrote it actually to encourage the believers so that they would go, wow, God, I don't know why you would choose me, but thank you. He wrote this to the people in his day, Peter, so that they would be encouraged in the midst of the situation they're in, that God's got you. So that's the first thing he says to them. He says that they're selected according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. But then he says this next. He talks about them being sanctified in the Spirit. They're sanctified. So you're elect, but you're elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. And then he says, in the sanctification of the Spirit. This word sanctification here is a word for consecration. It's actually the word for holiness. It's the idea of being set apart unto God. Now, when you think about sanctification, sort of this is a big Christian sort of word, right? Sanctification. Well, what is that? What does it mean? Well, there's kind of two ideas with sanctification, okay? There's what we call the sort of ongoing progressive sanctification. What this simply means is that when you become a follower of Jesus Christ, you are, from the moment you become a Christian until the day of your death, you are, hopefully, we all are, progressing, we're growing, we're becoming sanctified, more holy or more like Christ, right? We're growing and we're changing. We're a broken people. We make mistakes, but hopefully there's forward movement in our life, right, as we become more like Christ. That's progressive sanctification. But there's also another sense to sanctification, and that is this positional idea that the moment you become a Christian, you are set apart. You are sanctified. You have been made holy in God's eyes. And that is what launches you and I into progressive or ongoing sanctification in our lives. And what Peter is telling us here in this text is that they are elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. In other words, the Father selected, but secondly, it's the Spirit. The very moment you believe, the Spirit is the one who set you apart. He sanctified you. That is the electing work of the Father. What the Father did when he elected you from eternity past is made operative in real time the moment you become a Christian. The Spirit sanctifies you and sets you apart. You might, I don't feel too sanctified. No, we usually don't. But what the Father begins in there, he continues in a progressive way to help us to become more like Christ. And we have many times where we go back and forth and step forward and another step backwards, but he's moving us forward. And then the third thing Peter says in this part is that Peter, he reminds the believers that they've been sprinkled by Jesus Christ. He goes on to say that you've been elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in the sanctification of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. Notice again what's happening in this passage. The Father selected us, or the Father elected us, first one. Secondly, the Spirit sanctifies us, okay? Sanctifies us. The third thing is that Jesus sprinkles us, right? Now, I hope you're getting the sort of the parallelism, right? Selected, sanctified, and the last one here, sprinkled. Come on, you got to get this. This is like a preacher's dream, right? When you get the three words that line up all starting with S, I mean, come on. Right, this is the work of God in us.
you think about this. This is God's way of saying that for you as a follower of Jesus, in the culture in which you live in, where you're being maligned and where you're being mistreated and you're sort of out there in these five Roman provinces, that God, the one and only true living God, the God who exists as one God eternally in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God has been at work in you to bring you into salvation. He elected you, that is the Father. The Spirit sanctified you, and the Son sprinkles you with his blood. This is Peter's way of encouraging those early believers. He's encouraging them. Peter goes on in chapter 1 to say this about Jesus. He said to the church, knowing that you, church, were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Friends, we've been sprinkled with the blood of Jesus Christ. You see, that's how it happened. It's to this beleaguered group of churches then that Peter tells them that the Trinity was involved in their salvation, in their redemption. That's the first thing that Peter tells us, the first word. You're elect. You're chosen by God. You know, and there's nothing in us that should go, well, look at me, I'm elect. Like, there's no room for us to boast and say, I'm elect and you're not elect. God forbid that we would ever behave in such a way. You see, if you're chosen by God, if you've come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, you and I realize that there was absolutely nothing that you did, nothing that I did, to bring yourself to be part of that people, to bring you to election. That was entirely the work of the Father who selected you from eternity past. It's the work of the Spirit of God who sanctified you. It's the work of Jesus Christ. Are you saved by works? Yes, but hear me carefully. Not by your works, but by the works of Jesus Christ, what he did on the cross. That's what saves us. See, this is the truth that Peter hammers out in this passage. You and I to be encouraged by that. That strips us all of completely of boasting. I can't stand before God. None of us can stand before God and say, God, I did it. I contributed to it. I took part in it in the sense that you and I did this 50-50 or 98-2. Like, we can't do that at all. We simply stand back and we say, Lord, thank you. Thank you. I'm so grateful, God. So being chosen by God is no room for boasting. It's actually a room for just thanksgiving and praise. The second word that Peter gives to these churches is the word exiles. We've seen he talks about elect, but now exiles, and he has those two words sandwiched together, doesn't he, in the very first verse. But here's what he tells us in verse 1. He says, we are exiles on the earth. So we're elect, but we're also exiles. Peter says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are exiles, elect exiles of the dispersion. And then he tells us where, in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. I think there might be a map that you can see on the screen. You can see in this map those various Roman provinces back in the first century. Christians are scattered throughout these Roman provinces. This currently modern-day time is the country of Turkey. As a Christian, you can get gobbled up there. Wow. Yes, I went there. And you're not surprised, I'm sure. Oh, boy. I didn't even plan to say that. It just came to me. It's a gifting. It's a calling. I mean, it's... People are like, yeah, right, it is. So this is where the church was scattered in that time, right? They were in these various Roman locations. Now, when he says that they're in exile, elect exiles of the dispersion. Dispersions means they're sort of spread out into these various areas, right? But what does it mean for them to be in exile? The language of exile is actually language that really comes out of the Old Testament, right? If you think about Israel in the Old Testament, Israel was given the land of Israel that we have today. That land is their land, and he gifted it to them. And then Israel, when they sinned and they went into disobedience, which happened frequently throughout the Old Testament, God said to them, if you do that, I'm going to take you out of the land. And one particular occasion, there were several others, but one particular occasion, he brought in another nation entirely, the Babylonians, and the Babylonians took Israel out of their land, not absolutely everybody, they took a good amount of people out of the land, took them off to Babylon, and there they were in exile in Babylon. This happened in a couple of different times. There were actually three deportations of people out of Israel into Babylon. 586, 587 BC is one of them. It's when the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed. The way of life for Israel, for the Israelites, radically changed during that time. Consider, for example, the book of Daniel. Consider the character of Daniel and his three friends who became known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, living in Babylon. They are exiles. These are three or four, I should say, individuals are taken to Babylon. They are given a completely new country. I mean, just imagine it. This is not like my family and I moving from Canada to here. I mean, it's a new country. And this is much better. But don't tell everybody back home. But this is much better. But like the thing is, there's so much similarity still. But can you imagine being sort of taken to a completely foreign country that is so other than and different? I mean, you can't go to a Target store there, right? And you definitely don't have Chick-fil-A. So here they are in exile. They are given a new country. These individuals are given new names. They're given brand new types of food to eat. In fact, they were even said, you need to eat the food from the king's table. And they had to make a decision because there was something about the food, the way it was prepared or whether it was sacrificed to idols or whatever it was, that they said, I'm sorry, we can't eat the king's food. They were inserted into a whole new culture, a completely different worldview. I mean, they received a new education. All of them were educated in the ways of the Babylonians. They were also introduced to new and strange gods that they knew nothing about. They were worshipers of Yahweh, the one true God. I mean, it's kind of like for me, one of my favorite movie genres is sci-fi. I actually really got a kick over the years about watching all the Star Trek shows. I just found it personally for me, I like that sort of idea of just the thought of like them going off to another like galaxy somewhere, solar system, whatever, and finding like another planet that's habitable, and like just the idea of just sort of thinking about what would the people be like? We'd even call them people. And they just exploited that, right, in Star Trek. They just kind of like said, this is fun. Let's have fun thinking about this. I mean, what would their language be like? Would they speak? What would they eat? Would they be hostile? Would they be friendly? Would they have this similar foods? Would they have worship? Would they worship some other being, some other gods? It just was, for me, entertainment, fun watching that. And I think in some ways, when somebody goes into exile, it's almost like you've stepped into a foreign land. This is why some texts, as you read 1 Peter, some translations will say aliens. I mean, these individuals that Peter's writing to, he writes to them in some translations and calls them resident aliens. Because you feel like an alien. You're in a culture that you feel like, I don't belong in this. This is foreign to me. I mean, consider again what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were up against. They were told to bow down and worship other gods. Won't do it. We're going to heat up the furnace, and you'll end up doing it. Not going to do it. You see, when you live in a strange land, and you refuse to do the things that the people of the land do, you will stick out like a sore thumb. When you live in a strange land and you refuse to accept the customs, practices, beliefs, and the values of the people of the land, you will be seen as a little bit off, or maybe a lot off. A radical, a nut job, a crazy, a lunatic. this is what's happening here in 1 Peter to these scattered believers living in this Roman-dominated culture. They are exiles. You can see this, for example, in 1 Peter 4. Look what happens here. Peter says, "For the time is past, or for the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you." Boy, how true that is, isn't it? How true it is today. You see, when you live as an exile, when you live as a stranger in a strange land, and you don't do the things that people of the land do, you will stick out like a sore thumb. Those who follow Jesus, who take commitment to being a follower of Jesus seriously, most certainly stick out. I remember years ago reading about a young gal who was an actress. Her name was Charity Allen, and I remember she was given this incredible offer. She could have really promoted and moved and advanced her career as an actress. But there was just sort of one little twist to it. I mean, she was offered all kinds of sort of perks associated with this new role in a sitcom or a series, I should say. It wasn't a sitcom. And all it was that she had to sort of play this particular scene where she was a young woman who got impregnated, and then she ended up, because she was having this affair, and she had to have this particular scene, a bedroom scene. And she basically, at that point, as a follower of Jesus, said, I can't do that. I won't do that. But you know, today there are people that would, who claim to follow Jesus. But Charity Allen's like, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to compromise that. But other people are like, are you crazy? Like, are you out of your mind? You just passed up, like, millions of dollars? Like, popularity, fame, success, all that you've wanted? Do you think this opportunity is going to come around now? The people know? Sometimes we stand on our principles, upon the biblical values. Well, you know, we're not looking for trouble, right? We shouldn't look for trouble. I mean, unfortunately, there are people that look for trouble, followers of Jesus who look for trouble. You may recall sort of in the last couple of years, it's kind of been crazy a little bit in our world, and it's been crazy in Canada and crazy United States. I mean, crazy everywhere, right? Sometimes you wonder, well, what a strange land we live in. A couple of years ago, maybe that, not even long ago, you know, we've had at sporting events sort of like Pride Month, right? I just remember the one NHL player. There were others, but this one NHL player, he wasn't looking for trouble. He wasn't trying to make a difficult thing about it. He wasn't trying to be rude or obnoxious or offensive or anything like that. His whole team was told they've got to wear the Pride jerseys. And he just said, I can't do that. So, of course, the news got hold of it and maligned him in the news. But watching the interview with him, he just calmly and just really respectfully just said, you know, it's just, I'm a Christian, and I just, in conscience, I can't do that. I don't mean to be disrespectful to anybody else. I just can't do that. And man, did he get shredded for his position on that. Again, he wasn't looking for trouble. But he recognized that he's kind of at a crossroads at that moment, right? And when you're at a crossroads as a follower of Jesus, you have to make a decision. And sometimes it's then when you really see that you're an exile in this world. You're a stranger living in a strange land. You're like Charity Allen. You're like the NHL player. You're like a whole host of others who kind of in those moments have to say, I'm going to be looked at as a nut job and as crazy for doing this. But that's what it's like to be an exile. The idea of being an exile in a strange land is brought over by Peter from the Old Testament into the New Testament. It's Peter who brings it over, and he refers to the church as God's chosen people living in exile in those five provinces. We are not literally in Babylon, like Daniel and his friends, But I want you to take note of the very end of 1 Peter in chapter 5, verse 13, what Peter says. Chapter 5, verse 12 and 13. He says, "By Silvanus, a faithful brother, as I regard him, I have written briefly to you, exhorting and declaring that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it." Here it is in verse 13. "She who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son." What's he saying here? He's writing this from Rome. That's where he's writing this letter from. And he's writing it to the believers who are scattered in these five Roman provinces. That's what he's doing. But his way of referring to Rome is he calls Rome Babylon. That's what he does. He sees in sort of his contemporaries, the Romans and the way they're ruling and the church living amongst the Romans as if they're in exile, as if they're living in sort of a Babylonian-type culture. And he says, "She who is at Babylon," he's referring to the church. He's saying to the churches that are scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, he's saying to the believers there that the church over here in Rome, the church in Babylon, or at Babylon, who's also chosen by God, sends you greetings. Isn't that beautiful? See, he wants you and I to understand that throughout this whole book, we're strangers living in this strange land. You and I, just like them back then, we're not at home in this world. In fact, if we feel at home in this world, maybe we might be too much like the world. We are aliens. We're temporary residents. We're dispersed. We're scattered throughout this earth. The church is all over the world. It's not just here. It's not just in this building. It's not just in our other campuses here at Harvest. The church is all Bible-believing, faithful men and women of God scattered throughout this globe who confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And we are everywhere as God's people, chosen people. But we live in this world and we are like temporary residents here. The world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. So what then is their true home? You know, ancient Israel would look forward to being brought out of exile to go back home, back to the land, to be restored. But what about us? Well, here's our true home. In Hebrews 11, we're told about all the men and women who died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. That's us. We're strangers and exiles on the earth. Paul put it this way in Philippians chapter 3. He said, "Our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." Friends, yes, we have an earthly citizenship. We also have a heavenly citizenship. We have a king who really rules and reigns and is the king here, ruling and reigning in us, in you, and in me as we live in this world. Just like the followers of Jesus that Peter wrote to, we are elect and we are exiles. And maybe you look around at the world, depending upon your age, and you see how much it's changed over the last numerous years, 100 years, radical changes. Even the past 20 years, just think about what's changed. I mean, I can remember even just recently having a conversation about the internet. We didn't call it back then. I remember when it first came out, and younger people are like, "What? The internet came out? Like, it actually didn't always exist?" Like, no, it didn't always exist. We called it the World Wide Web at that time. You know, you get your $2,500 computer. I remember buying it, going, "Man, this thing." And you'd plug it in, and it, you know, the landline or whatever would be interrupted, and you'd hear all that noise, right? Would dial up, right? And I was like, "What? I don't understand. Information? How's this information even there? Like, is it just there? Or just put, you know, like, baffling, right? I mean, I'm still trying to figure out how fax machines work, so don't worry about me. That's why we got guys like Niaz who understand all these things. But, you know, like, that's just the technological stuff. And you think about the moral revolution that's taken place and just the speed of it. I mean, you look at Albert Mohler, for example, who's written a number of books, but his recent one, The Gathering Storm, where he talks about the rise of secularism that is sweeping across. It hit Europe first. It's taken over Canada. And secularism and secularization, the secularization is the process, right, through which we become a secular culture. Well, we live in a day and age that's so different than, so far removed from what it used to be. One time I was going through a Starbucks when I lived up in British Columbia, Canada. It was early in the morning, but going on my way to church. There was a young gal that served us at the window, and she said, "Where are you guys going off this morning, you know, kind of so early?" And said, "Well, we're on our way to church." And she's like, has no idea what church is. And I said, "Well, I'm a pastor." And she goes, "Well, what's a pastor?" You know, like a number of years ago, for some of us here, we'd probably go, that would have been unheard of 30 years ago. I mean, almost everybody would have known what a pastor is. Almost everybody would have had some kind of connection with spiritual matters like churches in some shape or form. But boy, things have changed where people don't even know. Erwin Lutzer, for example, in his great book called The Church in Babylon, said this. He said, "Christians find themselves in a whole new world that is vastly different than the one in which many grew up. America is losing much of the general religious ethos that was our cultural norm for hundreds of years. The culture is becoming increasingly polarized as the world around us becomes more comfortable admitting that the secularization, which has been an undercurrent, is now mainstream. The question we come to is this: how should Christians relate to this new world where they have lost home field advantage and the increasingly marginalized in popular culture?" Friends, I don't know if you feel that living today in the world in which you live, but I know I certainly do. So how do we live then? How then shall we live? And that's what Peter drives at. As those who are elect and those who are exiles, living in exile, scattered, feeling like strangers in this strange land, how do we live? There's really three options that I want to give to you. Of course, only one of them is really good, but this is how Christians often respond. Number one, some people will just isolate themselves. They will live in isolation. It's this idea of being the sort of living in a castle moat Christianity, I refer to it as. Sort of the world around us is going to hell in a handbasket. It looks horrible. Everything's falling apart. I'm going to retreat to my castle, pull up the drawbridge, let the alligators or whatever out. And if I have to go out, I'll go out, but I'm not going to really go out. And I might, from because I'm angry, I'm mad about the culture shifting, I'm mad about all the woke ideology, I'm mad about this and I'm mad about that, I'm going to be angry, mad Christian. I'm going to condemn people. I'm going to rebuke the culture. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to do it from my castle. It's so helpful. Not. I don't know people that really respond well to being yelled at and told that they're, you know, horrible people. The other option is what's called assimilation, which actually happens a lot. So you live in the culture, sort of the Babylonian type culture. What do people do? They become like a chameleon. I call them chameleon Christians. Sort of they change the color of their skin, so to speak, right? A chameleon does. I mean, whatever their environment is, their background, right? Oh, they're brown over here, they're green over here, they're light whatever over here. Christians who morally shift, right? They adapt to their environment. They see the culture and they accommodate to the culture. They allow the culture to so influence them and affect their views. But that doesn't happen just with individuals. It's happening a ton with churches too. They give up actually faithfully teaching the Bible and holding what the Word of God teaches. They cave. They succumb to LGBTQ+ ideology, to woke ideology, to at large sort of radical forms of feminism. And you could go on and on with issues that actually happen in the church. And most of those things, it's driven by a desire to assimilate to the culture instead of being faithful to the text. I would suggest to you that the last thing is infiltration, but infiltration without contamination. This is the posture of the Christians. I think of them as the saltwater fish Christians, right? Now, this probably will break down the analogy because some of you who fish, you probably go, well, actually, it's not true, but just work with me on this. A fish is in the salt water. That's its habitat, all of its existence, until you hook it and gut it. But, you know, until then, it's in its habitat. And yet somehow that fish that's immersed around the salty water doesn't become like completely like a sponge soaked with salt by God's design. Oh, it could taste fishy or might taste a little bit like metal or mineral sometimes, depending on where you're fishing. But it's not salty. It's not like you've drank a drink of salt water. It's been protected from that. You see, that's kind of how we should be, right? We're in the world, but we're not of it. We're like the fish. We're in this environment. It's all around us, but we don't become like the world around us, do we? We don't become like the world around us. And this is what Peter wants you and I to do. He wants us to be that kind of people. How should we live? What do you do when you live in exile in a strange country? Well, all the way back in the Old Testament, when Israel was sent into captivity in Babylon, they were not going anywhere. False prophets came on the scene and said, oh, you're going to be out of this in no time. And God came along and said to the true prophets, tell them they ain't going anywhere. They're going to be here for 70 years. So, you know, buckle your seats because you're going to be here. In other words, some of you who walked in here are going to die here. Like, most of you probably aren't going to make it through. You're an exile. Accept the fact that you're an exile. That doesn't mean you concede and you give concessions to everything and that you assimilate into and you sort of adapt to the culture, but you recognize, I ain't going to be changing this anytime soon. I live in this world. Here's the instruction that God gives in verse 4 in Jeremiah 29. He says, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles who I sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters, multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf for its welfare. In its welfare, you will find welfare. So he tells the exiles, here's what you need to do. Kind of adjust your thinking. You're not going back. You're not going back. You're in exile. So when you're in exile, settle down. Build strong families. Seek the welfare of the city. Pray for the city. Remember God's promises. This is what you and I do in exile. This is what Peter tells us as well in chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. He says, beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. What Peter is going to do in the unfolding of this book is he's going to help you and I understand how we can live as strangers in this strange land that we live in, that we can live as elect exiles, faithful to him in a culture, in a world that's so unfaithful to him. Let's pray. Lord, we give you praise and thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, that you love us. Lord, you know the times in which we live. I pray in particular, Lord, that you would help us not to be angry, mean, bitter, unhappy Christians. Lord, help us instead to see that you have placed us in this time, Lord, in this day, Lord, in exile, in a world that does not feel like at home increasingly, where we feel marginalized and minimized, we feel sidelined, we don't have home field advantage anymore, Lord. But in that, Lord, would you help us to let our light shine for Jesus, bright light shining, that city on a hill, where we could be witnesses for you and the world around us to a world that desperately needs the light of Jesus. We thank you that we can be this for you this week. In Jesus' name, amen.